I'd like to introduce our next speaker, a colleague and a friend. Deborah Hartman is the global scientific head of the Orexin Program at Centessa Pharmaceuticals. She is a PhD and a neuroscientist by training, with over 20 years in leading drug development research in the biotech and pharmaceutical industry. Dr. Hartman was previously Chief Scientific Officer at Orexia Therapeutics, which is now part of Centessa. Earlier, she was Vice President and Global Program Leader at Takeda Pharmaceuticals, leading the Orexin Program from 2017 to 2020. Deborah held prior research roles at AstraZeneca as VP of Respiratory and Inflammation Research in the UK, VP of Projects in Innovative Medicines for Infectious Diseases in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and VP of Lead Generation Enabling Sciences, also in the UK. Deborah started her career in drug discovery at Hoffmann La Roche in Basel, Switzerland, in neuroscience research, and worked briefly in metabolic diseases research in Nutley, New Jersey. Deborah received her bachelor's degree from Princeton University. She holds a PhD in molecular and cellular biology from Yale University. Thank you, Dr. Hartman, for joining us.
Thank you, Claire, for the very nice introduction. Very, very kind. It's really a pleasure to be here today. Thank you for the opportunity to be here at this very important conference to talk a bit about science and about drug discovery. I started working in orexin research about 6 years ago, and really, and what I've learned in that time has been has created a real passion in me about developing better medicines for idiopathic hypersomnia and narcolepsy. And the research at this point is moving incredibly rapidly, and I'm excited to have this opportunity to tell you a bit about where we are at this time. All right, so the title of my presentation is The Science Behind Orexin Agonists and the Search for New Treatments. This slide, you don't have to read, it's a very big, small text, but basically, it's a corporate slide, and it says that, you know, in my presentation today, there's a number of forward-looking statements, and in this rapidly developing field as in all drug discovery and research, things may change as we learn more. Okay, so in my presentation today, I want to introduce you to what is orexin. I know a number of you probably have heard that term multiple times. And why does it matter? I want to talk a little bit about how new medicines are developed and tell the story of the ongoing search for orexin agonists as potential new treatments for idiopathic hypersomnia, which I'll call IH, for narcolepsy, and potentially for other indications as well. So let's start with what is orexin? Orexin is a powerful signaling molecule in our brain that increases wakefulness, suppressing both REM, rapid eye movement sleep, and non-REM sleep. It also blocks some sleep-promoting signals. Orexin was discovered about 25 years ago by two different groups, and they gave it two different names. One called it orexin, the other called it hypocretin. They're both the same thing, and that's what's shown in that orange box there. Scientists have now discovered that orexin acts as the conductor of the orchestra for wakefulness in our brains. As you may know, there are multiple signals in the brain that work hard to keep us awake. And you may already be familiar with histamine, dopamine, noradrenaline. These are some of the natural chemicals in our brain called neurotransmitters that increase wakefulness. And those are shown on the slide in blue. Some current treatments for narcolepsy and IH enhance one or more of those signals. We're excited about orexin because it coordinates activation of all of these other signals. And as conductor of this orchestra, it ensures that the strings, the woodwinds, the brass, and the percussion are all producing a harmonious melody. And this results then in healthy wakefulness throughout the day. As you might guess, we have different levels of orexin during the day and during the night. And this is called diurnal variation. So take a look at the yellow curve on the right. In the morning, orexin levels are low, and they increase during the day to fight against this increasing sleep pressure that naturally occurs. And that orexin increase helps us to stay awake. At night, you can see orexin levels drop. And that difference is about 30%. from top to bottom. Interestingly, we don't understand it completely, but it does seem that some low levels of orexin at night may also help us to sleep. In clinical diagnostic procedures, orexin levels are measured in cerebral spinal fluid, and that's collected by a lumbar puncture or spinal tap because the brain is not directly accessible. So, how does orexin conduct this orchestra of wake signals? There are two orexin peptides, A and B, and these are short strings of amino acids that work like keys to unlock orexin receptors that are in the brain. There are also two different receptors, simply called orexin 1 and orexin 2 receptors. And orexin receptors are found in many parts of the brain. You can see those yellow lines again that are emanating out of that yellow dot, which is the hypothalamus, which is where orexin is made in the brain. And orexin then is stimulating receptors or unlocking these receptors in multiple parts of the brain to produce this well-coordinated symphony, if you will. Now, we know that in narcolepsy type 1, orexin is missing, and the orexin receptors remain locked and inactive. And this finding has helped us to learn a lot about the role of orexin in the body. So what happens when orexin is missing? This slide shows two hypnograms on the right, or graphs, that show a typical map of the time awake and the time asleep for a healthy individual on the top and an individual with narcolepsy type 1 on the bottom. The pictures here start at 9 a.m. in the morning and they show a 24-hour day. When a person is awake, you see a line right at the top of the graph, and then underneath that are the different sleep states, including REM sleep, which is shown with a blue dot, if you can see those. So on the top, with the healthy individual, you see a nice straight line during the day. That person is awake, and when it gets to be later at night, you see them falling into the different stages of sleep. In narcolepsy type 1, you see that this is very much disorganized, and that during the day, there are intrusions of sleep that occur when an individual is supposed to be awake. You also see that at night, there is more fragmented sleep, so the individual's waking up more at night. And this is then what happens when the conductor of that orchestra is missing. The loss of orexin in narcolepsy type 1, of course, causes many more symptoms than just excessive daytime sleepiness, as shown here. Cataplexy is a symptom that's seen only in NT1. For example, it's described as the sudden loss of muscle tone, usually triggered by positive emotions. And this can cause a full body collapse where a person is fully awake but can't move. Or it can affect just an arm, knees, neck, or facial muscles. Some symptoms, some of the other symptoms of narcolepsy type 1 are also found in narcolepsy type 2 and in idiopathic hypersomnia, which are two related conditions. But in NT2 and IH, orexin levels are usually normal. Excessive daytime sleepiness is clearly seen across all these symptoms. Brain fog and sleep inertia have been reported in all three conditions. Hypnagogic and hypnopompic hallucinations, where someone is falling asleep or waking up, are reported in both narcolepsy type 1 and type 2, and probably in about 30% of individuals. In IH, there are also cases where there's a much greater need for sleep than in the other indications, sometimes up to 11 hours or more. Because there is a similarity of symptoms, scientists have asked, you know, is it possible that if we develop treatments based on orexin, considering our knowledge of what orexin does, the lack of orexin in narcolepsy type 1, is there an opportunity then that those treatments might also have relevance for IH and narcolepsy type 2? Also important is that narcolepsy type 2 and idiopathic hypersomnia diagnoses can sometimes change. So if we listen carefully to individuals with that lived experience in IH, NT1, and NT2, we see across all three of these disorders that there is significant unmet need. They are all under-recognized and underdiagnosed. Treatment with multiple drugs is often required today, and there's a need for better treatment options with increased efficacy, better safety profiles, and more convenient dosing. This was captured really well in a very recent report written by Julie Flygar of Project Sleep that I would encourage people to read, that summarized an FDA listening session that was conducted with individuals and organizations representing sleep disorders. And the quotation here is from one of the participants who said, "I want to have better medicines so that I am not avoiding life and just surviving. We all deserve to thrive." So, as I've shown you, research is now pointing to the possibility of orexin agonists as a new approach worth exploring. Each orexin agonist is a key, and it's designed to unlock orexin receptors in the brain. By replacing what's missing in narcolepsy type 1, the hope is that an orexin agonist may have more, maybe more effective than current treatments and may act on a wider range of symptoms. By acting as this conductor of the orchestra for multiple wake signals in the brain, the hope is that orexin agonists may also provide benefit for IH and NT2. Multiple companies are now developing orexin agonists, so this is good news. And we expect that each of these compounds or keys will be somewhat different. In clinical studies, we'll be able to evaluate exactly which symptoms are well treated by these compounds. How long do the effects last? What are the safety profiles of these different compounds? And other questions that will ultimately determine which compounds will be approved and which ones will be prescribed. Okay, so that was a lot of science. And before I turn to talk about drug discovery, I wanted to invite some audience participation. My question to you is, how many years do you think it takes to develop a drug? So, first choice, feel free to stand up if you feel like you want to move around or just raise your hand. Do you think from start to finish it takes 1 to 5 years? No, okay, you guys are smart. Yeah, it's longer than that. 5 to 10 years. That is a hope for the future, Julie. Thank you, absolutely. Okay, 11 to 15 plus years. Yes, unfortunately, that is what we're currently seeing at the moment. And let me see where we are here. The typical stages of drug discovery and development are shown here. And yes, it takes typically an average of 11 to maybe 15, 16 years to develop a drug from start to finish. It's a highly regulated process that very carefully evaluates both the safety and efficacy of candidate drugs. And shown here in the US, two key decisions along the way are the investigational new drug application, the IND, which is the start then of clinical studies, and the new drug application at the end of those clinical studies, where all that data is collected and submitted to the FDA, where they review that for approval. So importantly, orexin agonists are now in development at various stages. They range from some are still in preclinical animal studies, some are in phase one, some are in phase two. So the field is moving forward and that clock is already running. What we measure in clinical trials is very important, of course. And again, if we listen carefully to individuals living with IH and narcolepsy, it's clear that we need better ways even to measure the effect of these compounds on symptoms. And that's summarized nicely here from another participant from the FDA listening session, where Amy says, as the FDA is looking at metrics and measurement and outcome measures, she would really love to see a way to better measure levels of functioning while awake, as this has the highest impact on her quality of life. I think that over time we will hopefully see better measures emerging that can be put into clinical trials to really be able to identify outcomes that are truly meaningful for individuals living with these disorders. Okay, so in fact, importantly, FDA has also picked up on this. They have created new guidance documents, four of them over the last few years, for drug developers that clearly emphasize the importance that they want to see direct input from individuals living with these conditions to be incorporated into the drug development process. They're expecting drug developers to better understand the therapeutic context of new treatments and this will advise them as well. So we're looking that, you know, these potential new treatments will be assessed in a way that we can truly determine if there's meaningful benefits. Okay, let's go for one more audience participation. Wondering if anybody has had an opportunity to participate in a clinical trial. And before I go into this, wanted to highlight there are many types of different clinical trials out there, and we saw a great example in Dr. Munn's presentation and with Matt about a survey study. So clinical trials can be drug trials. Has anybody participated in a drug trial? Wow, amazing. Quite a few. In a survey study, even more. Those are sometimes easier to accommodate. In a non-drug treatment study, I've seen studies, several people, like for meditation or other types of behavioral changes. How about a digital device study? That as well. Fantastic. I really want to just take the moment to say, you know, a sincere thanks on behalf of the entire research community for everybody who's participated in any of these kind of trials. Whether or not the drug or the device is successful, every trial contributes to our knowledge and is used to inform future research. And if you want more information, a great place to go is the website clinicaltrials.gov, which contains information about trials in all of these different areas. Okay, so let's talk a bit. I want to introduce you about the discovery of orexin and the journey from that point to how we've gotten to clinical trials today. So orexin and orexin agonists were first discovered in 1998, so about 25 years ago, not that long ago. It took about a year later for researchers to identify that there was a naturally occurring mutation in dogs that led to narcolepsy, and that was not in the orexin gene, but it was in one of the receptors, the orexin 2 receptor. And those dogs had not only the excessive sleepiness, but also cataplexy. And that showed us that the orexin 2 receptor was particularly important. Scientists were also able to create genetically engineered mice where those mice would lose the ability to produce orexin to model human narcolepsy. And those mice are important today for drug discovery to test compounds that are headed towards clinical studies. In the year 2000, then quickly after the discovery of orexin, it became clear that in narcolepsy type 1, orexin was missing. That if you looked in cerebral spinal fluid, that individuals there lacked orexin, as I had showed you earlier. And it's taken from the year 2000, almost, you know, quite a few years now, about 20 years, to get to the point of developing orexin agonists. On the way, the first orexin antagonist. So an antagonist is something that would block the receptor. It's like glue, right? It's going to get into that receptor, and it's going to ensure that that receptor does not get activated. And as you might imagine, an orexin receptor antagonist is used for insomnia to allow you to sleep at night. And those are sometimes easier to find. So 2014, we had the first orexin antagonist approved. Orexin agonists were first shown to work in mice, small molecules, in 2017. And then while the field during this time was working hard to find the small molecules that could be administered to humans, could enter the brain and be safe, it took until 2020 or so until the first reports came out of a proof of concept in a very small clinical study with a compound called danaforexin that was administered IV to show that in narcolepsy type 1, there was a reduction in excessive daytime sleepiness. And later it was shown also in cataplexy. Now those studies have continued with this first compound administered IV to look for proof of concept or look for signs of efficacy in other indications. And in just last year, a publication has now come out showing that this orexin agonist also had positive results in enhancing wakefulness and idiopathic hypersomnia. And I've actually put a slide in that to show you some of that data later. And as we are today, we have multiple companies who are now developing orexin agonists. So if we go back to that table of different symptoms, and we look at the studies that have been done with orexin agonists so far, you can see in the green boxes here, the green boxes highlight where the clinical data shows us effects today. So we can see across narcolepsy type 1, type 2, IH, and a study that was done in OSA, these orexin agonists, the orexin agonist danaferrexton now, publications have come out to show that excessive daytime sleepiness was reduced in all of those indications. And in narcolepsy type 1, cataplexy was reduced. So we've got a lot more symptoms to evaluate, and the importance now is to move also into the new orally administered compounds, which have the potential to be treatment, because the IV compound was used for proof of concept. And so it's these additional clinical studies now that are really key to help to test the effects of orexin agonists on other symptoms and to identify drugs, identify compounds that are going to be suitable for drug treatment. Here's the slide that I promised on the results shown in individuals with idiopathic hypersomnia. And what you can see is that the results are on the right. So study participants received either placebo, which is that small green bar, or study drug in blue at a clinical research site. And they were asked to stay awake in a dark and quiet room for 40 minutes. This is called a maintenance of wakefulness test. And it's the opposite, if you will, of the MSLT, which many of you may have experienced. So instead of being asked to go to sleep, you're asked to stay awake. And in a healthy person in this test can typically stay awake greater than 30 minutes, maybe 35 minutes, maybe the whole 40 minutes. So this test is repeated 4 times during the day, and then the numbers are averaged. How long was that individual able to stay awake over those 4 periods during the day? And you can see in this study that with placebo, the individuals, the participants in this study, stayed awake about 10 minutes on average. And with the treatment of danaferrexton, which was given by IV in this study, individuals were able to stay awake nearly the entire 40 minutes. So reaching that ceiling effect, if you will, of this test, and reaching normal levels then of wakefulness during this period, during this study. So clearly, much larger studies are needed to confirm these effects. These effects need to be shown with oral compounds, and we need to look at additional clinical outcome measures to be able to show that these are meaningful benefits in a real-life situation. But the results are very encouraging, and in fact, were quite surprising to scientists. Finally, I just wanted to share some research results with an orexin agonist compound that's in preclinical development by our team at Centessa. And here we've used mouse models, as I described earlier. These are really critical in drug discovery because you want to be able to demonstrate that your compound is working in the way that you're anticipating it is. You know, you're testing numbers of compounds and selecting the best ones as you're moving through drug discovery. So here, we used both the narcolepsy model mice, shown on the left, who lack orexin. They're genetically engineered to lack orexin, and wild type or healthy mice on the right. And you can see this compound, which we call ORX750, increased time awake in a narcolepsy type 1 mouse model, showing maximum sleep wake promotion, actually reaching, again, the ceiling effect in this study, maximum level at all doses shown on this slide. And in addition, in the healthy wild type mice shown on the right, the compound also supported wakefulness in a dose-dependent manner. And this supports potential indication expansion then into these other indications, such as IH and NT2, that actually have normal orexin levels. So in summary, research and development of orexin agonists is progressing very rapidly, with multiple companies now involved in this search. To be successful, though, we need to listen. We need to listen and learn from those living with conditions in order to develop our drug development programs in the best possible way. We need to work closely with physicians and with regulators to design and conduct high-quality clinical trials. I guess it's important to point out as well, and I should have mentioned this on my slide about drug discovery, only one or fewer than 1 in 5 compounds that enters drug development is actually approved as a drug. There are many, many failures along the way, and it's important that those failures teach us a lot as well. And we need to learn from both the successes and failures, continue to drive the science forward to better understand the underlying causes of these indications, and in that way, design the best possible treatments. So thank you very much for listening today. Thanks for continuing to share your experience and advice so generously with all of us who are doing research in this field. Thank you for participating in research whenever you can, and for being part of this journey towards the development of orexin agonists as potential new treatments. Hopefully together we can bring back this music of healthy wakefulness for all of those who suffer from sleep and wake disorders. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hartman. Dr. Hartman is available to take several questions if anyone wants to raise their hand and has a question about the content.
About the science.
Okay. Did your data show any evidence that this affected any of the neuropsychological types of symptoms that patients have?
Yes, that's a good question. I think that those types of measures need to be looked at. I would recommend that you take a look at the articles that have been published to look at the data that's available out there. So they're not my compounds, but there's a number of publications out there. And I think that what you raise is a really important question, that we need to be looking beyond just sleepiness and beyond just cataplexy, but for a broader spectrum of effects that these compounds may have. But the data really needs to be collected to look at those type of symptoms.
As far as the medication goes, is there research that shows the duration where the effectiveness does patient or possibility where it's going to not be effective in 3 years, or is this a long, long term?
I'm not sure I understand the question, but I'll. Is the question more about how long
my experience lasts? With medications now, I have KLS, so the medications aren't designed for that, but they work for a while, they don't work, or like the body, or that's more what I'm referring to.
Oh, yes. No, I think you raise an important point. It's an experience that people have with current medications. I think for these new medications, there's so much to learn. There's no information available for that. It needs to be assessed as part of clinical trials and then as part of monitoring, treatment effects. But no information available. Okay, thank you so much. It's been a pleasure. Thank you.